just very quickly, you should have received a postcard or will soon that we are going to have a special congregational meeting here on August 16th. That's a Sunday. And we'll meet right out here in the parking lot again. So more details about that are coming out this week. And so watch for that in your email or regular mail. And then lastly, our school supply drive is continuing on. And so supplies can be dropped off at the home of Jenny Caesar. And she will welcome those this coming week. That's all the announcements I have. And so we're going to start our worship with a special song that is a familiar tune, but the words have been written by none other than Bruce. So let us worship. Are restored, you are reconciled, and you have the promise of resurrection. creation with abundance. Awaken in us a hunger for the food that satisfies both body and spirit. And with this food, fill all the starving world through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. We'll continue now with our scripture readings. A reading from the book of Isaiah, the 55th chapter. Isaiah writes, "Ho, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. And you that have no money, come, buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me and eat what is good, and delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me. Listen so that you may live. I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. See, I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and commander for the peoples. See, you shall call nations that you do not know, and nations that do not know you shall run to you because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you." And now a reading from the Gospel of Matthew, the 14th chapter. Now when Jesus heard this, he withdrew from there in a boat to a deserted place by himself. But when the crowds heard it, they followed him on foot from the towns. When he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion on them, and he cured their sick. When it was evening, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a deserted place, and the hour is now late. Send the crowds away, so that they may go into the villages and buy food for themselves." Jesus said to them, "They need not go away. You give them something to eat." They replied, "We have nothing here but 5 loaves and 2 fish. And he said, "Bring them here to me." Then he ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven, and he blessed and broke the loaves, and gave them to the disciples. And the disciples gave them to the crowds. And all ate, and were filled. And they took up what was left over of the broken pieces, 12 baskets full. And those who ate were about 5,000 men, besides women and children. This is the gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Jesus said, "You give them something to eat." And I wonder if when he said that, the disciples didn't consider just running away and never looking back. Because the crowd, we learn at the very end of this reading, the crowd was mammoth. It was huge. People had followed Jesus, it seems, all the way around the Sea of Galilee, and had picked up followers of all ages and stages in every town along the way. The men alone numbered 5,000, and the injustice of only counting men is a subject for another time. But add in women and add in children, and you have the potential for 10 to 15,000 people amassed about the countryside. I mean, I gotta tell you, I get nervous thinking about planning a meal for the 4 people in my house. And that's with recipe books and grocery stores nearby. I can't imagine looking at a ginormous group of people, even all of you here gathered in the parking lot today, and being told, "All right, go on now, you give them something to eat. Come on, Jesus." I wonder, too, if the disciples didn't think that maybe Jesus was just kind of messing with them a little bit. In the gathering twilight, it must have been hard for them to see. Was there a little twinkle in his eye as he said this? Or was he serious? Or was he going to tell the story? Or was he going to do something else entirely? So they hedge their bets, and they offer up the little that they can scrounge up. "All right, Jesus, it's a huge crowd. It's a crowd that's big enough that if we tried to send them away to the surrounding villages, that's probably not even going to work because there's so many of them. And all we have here, we got 5 loaves, we got 2 fish. Now, unless those loaves were the size of semi-trucks and the fish are blue whales, that's probably not going to be enough." My sympathy laugh is back! Yes! And yet it is enough. You give them something to eat. So often, I feel like we have that same mindset as the disciples. The problems are too huge. Our resources are too small. Too many people are hungry. Too many people need healing. Too many people are oppressed. Too many people are homeless. Too many people are hurting in so many ways. The crowd is ginormous, and we have so little. precious little to offer. Our resources, even pooled together as a congregation, seem like so little in the face of such great need. I mean, sure, we can amass a pile of school supplies for kids in need, and yet we know that many of those children who will receive them are likely facing hunger, possibly eviction from their home, and many of the other issues that accompany chronic poverty. We know that this year in particular is going to bring about additional challenges for families on the edge. And we know that we can give food to the food pantry, and we can sponsor a child through compassion, and we can donate a pint of blood here and there. And yet we know that poverty here and around the world, it's not going away. We know that not every sickness can be cured and not every wound can be healed. All we have is, and we name off what feels to us like so little. And that honestly is what we have in a good year. This year, throw in all of the chaos and the confusion of the pandemic, the exhaustion that comes along with that, the short tempers, the arguing about public policy and everything else, and our 5 loaves and our 2 fish, they kind of feel like 5 little crumbs and 2 stale goldfish crackers. On a good day, you give them something to eat, Jesus says, but all we have is... And then Jesus does what Jesus does. The disciples respond to his impossible request with a reminder of how few resources they have, and Jesus doesn't say, "Aw, nuts, well that blows that plan out of the water, forget it, just send them away." Jesus doesn't laugh at them, he doesn't mock their meager supplies, he beckons, "Bring them here to me, bring them here to me." Jesus knows that no one of his followers has everything needed to resolve every issue that plagues this world. Jesus knows that no one congregation has enough resources to fix everything in their community. Jesus knows that we worry a lot. We worry a lot about not having enough. And then Jesus goes on and reminds us that in his hands, whatever it is that we have, it's enough. He looked up to heaven, he blessed and broke the loaves, and gave them back to his disciples. "Go on now, you give them something to eat." It wasn't a trick, it wasn't a test, it was a calling. You give them something to eat, and remember that I'm going to supply you with what it is you need to do that. And so sure, it's true that all by ourselves we can't fix everything, but when we give over our loaves and our fishes to Jesus, when we entrust what we have to him, we'll see that in his hands, things multiply and grow beyond our wildest dreams. Sure, those boxes of markers that you brought to Jenny's house, they might not seem like a whole lot, but to the child who receives them, they're everything. They're a sign that the community cares. They're the dignity of having your own stuff and not having to borrow from friends. They're the joy of something new just for them. In Jesus' hands, the smallest things given in love can take on so much more. So yes, the disciples were absolutely right. Those crowds were huge, and we're right. The needs out there are so great. But Jesus is righter, and when we place what we have in his hands, we're going to see how quickly he multiplies our efforts to bring about the life and abundance and hope that define his kingdom. And we'll see that how much Jesus wants us to be a part of all this too. Jesus doesn't grab those loaves and fishes and say, "Fine, I'll just do it myself." He blesses the loaves and then blesses his disciples with the gift of being distributors of the miracle, agents of the miraculous. I mean, how cool is that to be a part of it? Jesus was the one behind the miracle. He made it happen, but he allowed and invited his disciples, like us, to participate in it in a real and meaningful way. They got to see the surprise and the delight on the faces of the hungry people as they were given this unexpected holy meal out in the middle of nowhere. Jesus didn't keep that joy to himself. He shared it with his disciples. And in the same way, Jesus invites us to be a part of the everyday miracles in our world. And he doesn't do this all on his own. He invites us to partner with him in bringing about this world of justice and hope and mercy and compassion. Jesus invites us to be a part of the fun, doubly. ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We continue now with our offering and anthem. Again, we thank you all for your continuing to support our mission and ministry here at Christus. If you've brought your offering along with you today, there will be a box as you exit the parking lot, and you can deposit your offering in there. So again, thank you all for your support, and now let us enjoy our anthem with Rochelle. Church trusts that what you bless and ask us to share with the world is abundantly sufficient. God, your bountiful creation offers sustenance and life for all creatures. Protect this abundance for the well-being of all. Reverse the damage we've caused your creation. Replenish groundwater supplies, provide needed rains in places of drought, and protect forests from wildfires. God, you offer yourself to all the nations and peoples of the earth, inviting everyone to abundant life. Bring the prophetic vision to fullness that all nations will live in harmony with one another, and that all leaders would be wise, just, and filled with compassion. God, you open your hand and satisfy the desire of every living thing. Hear the anguish of tender hearts who cry to you in suffering and satisfy their deepest needs. Bring wholeness and healing to those who suffer in body, heart, soul, and mind, and those we name before you now. Tom, Wayne, Wendy and Jay, Jackie's mom, Jerry, our United States of America, Elizabeth and family, Dick, Susan and Stephen, Karen in thanks for a successful surgery, Janet, Jake, David, Karen for healing and strength, Riley and family, Mike, Dawn, and all those we name before you now. God, please hold them close to your heart and give them your peace. God, you offer freely the fullness of salvation. Give our congregation such a welcoming heart that our words and actions may extend your free and abundant hospitality to all to whom we encounter. And now, in the certain hope that nothing can separate us from your love, we offer these prayers to you through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Continue now by celebrating Holy Communion. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. He gave thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, and it's given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "Take and drink. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, and it's shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And now let us join together in praying our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Jesus Christ, may it strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. And now God, the Creator, Jesus the Christ, and the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, bless you and keep you in eternal love. Amen.